This isn't the first time. When Fox News' Chris Wallace asked the president in June if he'd accept the election results, no matter the outcome, the president said, quote, I have to see. But his answer to that question yesterday came with a much starker warning. Here's the exchange.
Win, lose, or draw in this election, will you commit here today for a peaceful transferal of power after the election? And there has been rioting in Louisville. There's been rioting in many cities across this country, red and your so-called red and blue states. Will you commit to making sure that there is a peaceful transferal of power after the election?
Well, we're going to have to see what happens. You know that I've been complaining very strongly about the ballots, and the ballots are a disaster.
I understand that, but people are rioting. Do you commit to making sure that there's a peaceful transferal of power?
We want to have, get rid of the ballots, and you'll have a very we'll have a very peaceful, there won't be a transfer, frankly. There'll be a continuation. The ballots are out of control. You know it. And you know who knows it better than anybody else? The Democrats know it better than anybody else. Go ahead.
The president bluntly stated that his push to get a ninth justice on the bench before the election is so he can strengthen his hand should the Supreme Court have to decide the election.
And I think this will end up in the Supreme Court, and I think it's very important that we have nine justices. This scam that the Democrats are pulling, it's a scam. The scam will be before the United States Supreme Court, and I think having a 4-4 situation is not a good situation.
So Barton, let me ask you about your report that Trump will first claim victory before mail ballots are tabulated and then prevail in Republican-controlled state legislatures to appoint their state's electoral college votes to Trump, circumventing the votes altogether. That is how that's your chief concern. Talk about how that would happen.
We're used to the idea that we cast votes and then the popular vote winner in a state gets that state's electoral votes. But the Constitution doesn't say it has to be that way. Trump and his people are aware of this. The state legislature has the power, according to the Supreme Court, to seize back from the people the decision over who the electors will be. And Trump's people are talking about a strategy in which they would go to the legislatures in some of the six swing states that are controlled by Republicans in the legislature in both chambers and say, you should reject the vote count because it's corrupt, because it's rigged, because it's filled with fraud. And you should therefore appoint electors that would be Trump electors, regardless of the vote, to cast aside the vote.
So let's be clear here that in the swing states of Michigan, Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, you have Democratic governors, but you have Republican legislatures there. You have Republican legislatures in Ohio and Florida as well. Are you saying that Donald Trump's campaign and his lawyers are talking to some in those legislatures and telling them to overthrow the will of the voters in those states?
Well, I know that they've had that conversation with the head of the Republican Party in Pennsylvania, who told me so. And I know that the Pennsylvania Senate Majority Leader and Speaker of the House are aware of this talk and have talked among themselves about the possibility. Trump is running a campaign premised on the idea that he can't win enough votes if all the votes are counted. and that he has to change venues. He has to change to a different way of counting. And the thing about a presidential election is that it depends on the concession of the loser. If the loser won't concede, and in particular if the incumbent won't concede, he's got a bunch of different reps that he can work. There's no single umpire with the ability to say, okay, the game's over, we've called it score. The American system isn't built a single efficient umpire that way.
So let me ask, that seems to me, we've already had a Supreme Court ruling earlier this year on electors that didn't follow the will of their of the people in their states. Would it then go to the Supreme Court of the United States to force the state legislatures to follow the will of the people in their states?
They were different kinds of cases, and it's not necessarily the courts that this would go to. It would probably go to the court as well. But the Electoral Count Act, which was passed after the only other time in American history that we've had a debacle like this, with possibility of multiple competing slates of electors, where two different groups of people said, I'm the elector for the state of Pennsylvania, for example, it's supposed to go to Congress. Congress is supposed to decide who are the legitimate electors, if any, from that state. And the problem is that the Electoral Count Act is one of the most garbled and indecipherable statutes ever passed by Congress, which is saying a lot. And there are a number of scenarios, likely scenarios, if you still have a split of control between the House and the Senate, in which Congress can't make the decision, in which you have both sides deadlocked. They sort of checkmate each other on who are going to be the people who cast the votes from, in this case, Pennsylvania. And the problem is that when you have chaos going on for a long time, which is Trump's strategy here, then as time passes, the president, the person who's got the troops under his command and has the apparatus of the federal government at his command, is going to take advantage of that deadlock and stay in power.
What do you see as a professor of government happening in that space from election day until date unknown when all the votes are counted?
I don't think we have any idea. Barton has laid out the possible scenarios, and they're very grim. It's going to be essential for the public to demand a fair and complete count in that moment. That is the ultimate constraint on potential abuses of power in that time. It's a period of unique vulnerability, that period between when the votes are first cast and when we have an ultimate resolution. And as Barton has suggested, there is a potential for the president and his allies to destabilize that process, to sow chaos, and to then use that chaos as a pretext to try to undermine the validity of the result if it goes against them, or to try to change the outcome of the election. And I want to be clear, this is a democratic emergency. Sometimes you see things on television and maybe they're hyped up a little more than people think. This is something that experts are incredibly alarmed about. My colleagues who study the erosion of democracy in other countries are terrified of what they're seeing in the United States. This is straight out of the textbooks of how countries slide out of democracy and into authoritarianism.